on.
Yo.
What's up, what's up?
Peter, do you hear that? Peter, do you hear that sound that you're playing?
Yes.
That road sound?
Well,
that's me.
Oh. Which sound do you mean? Wait, let me get a little more volume here.
I gotcha.
Okay.
Yeah, that new road sound, you like that?
Yes.
That's a little keyscape for you, buddy. Enjoy that. How nice is that, huh? Oh, yeah. That's Peter Martin, everybody. I'm Adam Maness. We're just waiting to go live. Give us a like, and we will turn on the cameras, although I'm not sure. But anyway, Peter, what do you think? That sound.
I mean, listen.
Wait, that sound.
Now, would that be something you might be interested in?
Yes, it is.
Ah! Pick and Stone says, is the actual roads in the studio going to be fixed ever? Well, Pick and Stone, you're going to find out actually in just a couple weeks.
Got an answer for him already.
We might be recording something on it this coming week.
Thank you. What's up? What's up?
Hey.
How you doing, Adam?
Pretty good, man. That coffee kicked in right at the right
time. It did.
Time.
Oh, it my did. God. Big shout out to, these are our friends in...
Feeling good.
Oh, no, these are not. These the coffee is from a little place called Intelligentsia. Big sponsor. They just don't know it yet. You know about that? Sponsors in advance,
we
call that.
Can we get some Intelligentsia love? I'll tell you what, man. Loving the new sounds. We got to get this together, though, because I feel like we're on the same channel. It was a little bit of like a...
It was. Was I a little distorted there, folks? Maybe, well, maybe it was just in my headphones.
I'm going to try to... So, folks, we got some brand new, very expensive keyboard sounds. We paid a pretty penny. This might be a little better. But also, are we a little shaky here? Come on, Peter.
I think we're good. I don't know.
We've been doing,
folks, let us know. This is camera angle 2. That's camera angle 3. He's doing the side robot. He's doing the frontal. He's doing the high ridge robot right there. And then this is the one that he's questioning.
It just seems a little jumpy.
Is it seeming jumpy? A little distorted.
I just want to make sure that we're all good. We haven't really started the show. I know y'all are here. I know everybody's here.
Distorted. Yeah, we might be a little bit hot.
It's a little distorted.
Because you know what it is? I played when we were sound checking. I always do this. Quick tip for pianists.
Check
this
it.
Is hard
check
to
it.
Do. Yo. Drummers are good at this. In the sound check, play at the same level.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, like as in loudness that you're going to play on the gig. It's just hard to do that.
Stay
you know
there,
what I'm saying?
Stay there.
Okay, stay here. Right here. Whoa. But it's like, you know, even if you're not playing it, definitely on an acoustic piano, I always have trouble with that. I'm sound checking. And a good engineer will be like, give me everything you got. But when you're not playing with the drums, you know, and everything, it's kind of hard. Yeah, Adam does have he has a double espresso. It's not looking jumpy here, they say. I think this is the angle in question. I'm going to tell Adam about...
15 frames per second.
Was it? We don't know what's happening here. Adam, I was just about to tell them one thing I was practicing. I've been going back to my practicing intense. What do you know about that?
Yeah, so...
Are you a fan of that?
No, hit me to that.
Well, it's just as it sounds. It's doing stuff intense. But I was doing some, you know, chromatic... You know I love the chromatic scale.
I do,
if
too.
If I have any faults...
Oh, so you were doing like a...
Yeah. I love starting there and then maybe even a little... Broken minor third.
Yeah, wait. Yeah, so hold on. So you're literally... Oh, DGPSers, we got to try this.
Yep.
That's crazy.
Yeah, cray. Wow. And then there's so many fun things you can do with that. And I like to look at this as a challenge, like, you know, for wrist positioning, fingering, going in and out of the key bed at the right times. That's minor still, but you can go major. That's mine. You can go. You can go contrary. Would you call this contrary motion?
No, that's... well, yeah, that is contrary. Yeah.
But you can also go straight contrary motion.
See, folks, this is why Peter's so good.
No.
Look at him. Look at his practice routine. Look at that. So you're... Hold on. So you're going... Wait a second. So you're going... Major thirds out?
Yeah. Wait, go back to where you're starting. Yeah, go make major thirds.
Jeez.
Well, you know, but you can do minor thirds. Minor thirds is cool too. Really, you can do whatever.
You're nuts, buddy.
Yeah.
Okay, well, DGPR says, I think we know what we're doing for warm-ups next week.
And, you know, quick tip for pianists or for anybody out there, if you're not, like, you know, big up on this stuff, it's okay. You can slow it down and be like... Actually, the minor third is a better one to start at. Let's give it an angle there. And then, you know, start out looking when you need to, but try to get away from looking at the keyboard as quick as you can and really do this as a tactile kind of by feel thing.
That's insanely difficult, I think. Hold on. Oh, I'm going to try it slowly.
Yeah. That's not that slow either.
Ha. Dude. I wonder why this guy's got such a big brain.
And you know, I used to do a thing like, too. I would be like, these are all like, they're very easy to make them progressive without having to like plan it out too much. So like, you just kind of think about like, okay, where could that go next? like on the minor third.
Dude, what are you doing? Let's do that again.
So those are just diminished triads. So you're starting with the minor thirds, right? Then you're just stacking another minor third on it. Yep.
I'm going to close my eyes. Jeez, man.
Yeah. And what it starts to do, too, is gives you independence of the hands, of course, but also independence of those shapes. It really gets those engraved.
James Alexander says, you'd play that over a five or what?
No, but
great
all
question.
These,
James,
all
no, this is purely for our own enjoyment.
This is for party tricks.
Yeah, this
no,
is
no,
really...
but this, the great thing about this, you can start, I know I'm jumping a bunch of steps, but even if you just go straight, start on a minor third, right? That's why I like, that's where do we start? With the chromatic scale, right? I always admit, I instinctually slow down when I mess it up.
So I'm just geeking out over these road sounds, man.
I know, they kind of get it.
You know what I mean?
Ah, a little steel. Wait, we can't even say that word, can we?
What? Steely Dan?
Feely Sam. Feely Let's man? Call it Feely Sam so we don't get copyright dinged.
Greasy Jan?
Greasy Jan. What's up, Adam Maness?
What's happening, Peter? Man, I feel like I haven't seen you in forever, but we just were like hanging out so much last week.
Yeah. We got a little burnt out on each other, let's be honest.
I mean, dude, it's been a it's no, been yeah. a the pandemic, man. It's been intense.
Yeah.
Intense,
but yeah.
All good. Yeah, Keyscape, Danny. It's good stuff, right? Yeah. So, oh, man, I'm
excited. Oh, somebody mentioned on here earlier when we were playing about the Greg Fillinganes Keyscape on YouTube. Highly recommend that. Just search Keyscape. Like a... There's actually Herbie does one. I think that's up on there. That might be a private thing. But he did one, maybe Jacob Collier, where they're just like, I mean, they have it mixed so well, but like demoing different sounds, like the Yamaha CF Grand, the Rose, but Fillinganes. I mean, I can hear Greg Fillinganes play anything.
I'm telling you what, we've used a few different sounds here.
Yeah.
Right? For our podcast.
Yeah.
We've had Piano Tech before. That's what we've been using. And I love Piano Tech, Danny, but I got to say, it's way better.
Right.
Keyscape is a lot better.
Wait, could we play this on here? Would that work?
Yeah.
Can we enjoy this together? Would that
yeah,
be something
yeah, yeah,
that,
yeah. Share the screen, man.
If I... Well, easier said than done.
I'm going to noodle along.
No, I'm going to send it to you. Can I send you something?
Sure.
Okay. HTTP... Can you type this in?
Are
HTTPS...
You, are you serious right now?
No.
What is it?
Kind of.
Is it just a YouTube video?
No, here, I'm going to drop it in... It's a YouTube. Search Keyscape... Keyscape
Session, Greg Philly. I got
yeah.
it. Yeah. You give me HTTPS. Son of a gun.
Can you throw it over on the...
Let me see if I can.
Would that be something that would interest you?
Now, would that be something you might be interested in?
Yes, it would be. I don't need to say it anymore. That's so great.
Hold on.
Just want to... I have some funny images here. Now, we'll see folks that are in the chat that are watching today. Welcome, everybody. But I want to see who remembers...
Okay.
Before we even do this, I got so much. I know you got your little show prepared for us,
buddy. I work hard on this.
But look, I got a couple things. I'm gonna call it audible here. We're gonna throw up an image here, okay?
Okay.
It's a still image.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
And what we're gonna do? We're gonna see how quickly folks in the audience,
okay,
our beloved fans, our friends, as it were, can identify in the chat why I would have this image on here. I have some random images on here. Some of them make sense, like Miles Davis. You know, there's like the Mulgrew Miller. Folks remember when we talked about it. But this has nothing to do with jazz, but somehow we pulled it in, okay?
Okay.
And Adam, that guy, Adam Maness, are going to be part of this too. So you might want to give it a second.
Okay.
We're going to check into the chat, but I want to see if you
I'm
remember.
Very intrigued. I have no idea what the hell is going on.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
We're just going to throw it up there.
Do it.
Are you guys ready in the chat? Let me pull up the chat so we can see it. All right, ready to go? Here we go.
Okay.
Hey, Willie!
That's my elf.
Okay, but why? Okay, see if anybody knows. Okay. Ding.
Does someone have it?
No. Does anybody
why would we have, are you saying why would we have this image?
Yes. Why would we have this image?
I know. Why? I know why.
Wait, let's throw it up one more time for our listeners and viewers. Yeah, Alf. We know it's Alf. He already said that. That's good. I like that you guys got that. But why do I have that image? Why did we show that in an earlier episode? What was the reference point?
Has anyone seen the cat? Hey, Bri.
What episode is that from?
You don't even know what episode this is from. Because this was
I just remembered. No. I do remember.
This
was
at the end of an episode.
Oh, that's true.
Well, this wasn't an episode about what you're talking about. I know what you're talking about. I have no idea what episode this is from.
That's true. I don't either.
And I don't think it's available on YouTube anymore, Peter. This is only live, man. This
Somebody
is...
said Peter in an earlier life.
Ouch. Damn.
Ow. You'll hear it.
But actually, this is going to tie in nicely to next week's You'll Hear It Live, because we're going to be doing more on what you're talking about. I will fill them in. This was at the very...
Wait. We're going to see if anybody got it yet. How old are you by saying Alf? Yeah. Peter in an early life. Ha. You'll hear it. Even for us sax players, you guys are great. What is it all about? Alfie? Oh, that's not a bad... Alfie, that's not a bad guess, but no. Are you going to break it down?
We do love a terrible pun, so that's not a bad guess at all.
Yeah.
So we did an episode. I don't even know what the episode was. I think it was one of our real book ones or something. I forget what it was. But at the end, we started just playing TV themes. Just like,
hey,
you remember that TV theme?
Right.
Like we're a bunch of like frat boys at the end of a Wednesday night.
Right.
You remember that TV show from when we were kids?
Yeah.
But and then we just started like playing TVs. Now next week, we're going to go on our like heavy hitter musical TV themes. And we're going to actually do a proper episode and breakdown of things that you might remember, like... That's a movie.
Oh, okay, we can't do that.
We're doing TV themes, Peter.
Okay,
stay with me.
Okay.
I'm talking maybe Good Times, Flintstones. Are we really going to break down the Flintstones?
I mean,
we did talk about
it. That's like the
actually.
Only jazz.
No, but the Love Boat, we talked about Family Ties.
Boat. Yeah.
We talked about
Come
Night
and
Court.
Knock on our door.
Talked about Nike. We talked about Quantum Leap. Do you remember we talking about Quantum Leap? Barney Miller, So Funky.
Oh.
Taxi. We got to break down some Bob James and some Taxi. You know what I mean? Huh. Some What's Happening. You know
what
I mean?
That's Barney Miller. What's Happening?
Some Moving On Up to the East Side.
Yeah, maybe a little Sanford
and
Son.
Sanford and Son for sure has got to be in there.
Sanford and Son, fun fact. We're going to have some jazz tie-in, because that's actually written by, I believe, ghostwritten by none other than the great Benny Golson.
That would make sense.
Yeah.
That makes
I can't
sense.
Remember Sanford and Son right now. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. There it is. He's got it. So anyway, that's going to be the MASH theme song, Suicide is Painless. Beautiful song. Okay, we got sidetracked from our friggin' sidetrack, buddy.
Of course.
It's already 3:24.
Come on, we're having a good time. How you guys having a good time? I Dream of Jeannie.
So Greg Filaganis.
Greg Filaganis.
Greg Filaganis.
Greg
Louganis.
Oh, no relation, I don't think. Greg Louganis.
Greg Filaganis.
Greg Filaganis. Both Gregs. Both world champions.
Okay.
So do we want to play this? You got that up?
That's up. It's ready to go. Camera four, man.
Hold up. Got a lot going on here. How was your week, by the way? Oh, we talked about that already. YouTube or sounds. Okay, so here we go. You got sound too, though?
Wait.
Boom. Check. Let's check for sound.
Oh, yeah.
No, there's no sound. That's only for us.
No, they can hear that.
No, they can't. Oh, they can't?
Yeah. Okay. It sounds like what we got going on today, buddy.
This is so great, though.
That's so good.
Yeah.
Woo.
I wish I knew the lyrics. I could sing it right. You know I know.
I mean, that's so close to the Michael McDonald Road sound. It's amazing.
Well,
that's just dandy.
That's so great, man.
This stuff he plays is fun. That was it?
Hey, I was just playing this.
Yeah.
Actually, I was playing the other one.
Right.
Same kind of structure.
Ooh, I mean, it's got the phaser.
Phaser. Little peg.
Yeah.
I can just watch him do this all day.
He's something I'm interested in.
Here. Now, would that be something you might be interested
yes,
in?
Yes, it is.
So that's all Keyscape sounds. That's live in the Keyscape studios.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
That's very cool, Peter. Cool? Oh, I'm glad we got to watch that. Hold on. Sorry.
I'll drop a little link to that in here in case anybody wants to.
Sorry, Greg.
Wants to watch that.
Okay, so somehow, though.
Cool.
Lost our sound slice.
Oh, come on. Come on. Okay, so what are we actually talking about today? First of all, welcome.
There it is. Got it back.
We can allow that. So today, well, first of all, in case we have any new folks, what's happening? What's going on? Welcome to Monday. We do a little bit of witless and witty banter, as it were.
Dude, it's all witless.
It's all witless.
Give me a break.
This is Adam Maness right here.
What's going on?
I guess we did this already. I'm Peter Martin. But you know, some people show up late to the party.
No, so we actually, for those of you who are new, we haven't even started the show yet.
I love how we have to tell, we're like, don't leave. It gets better. We haven't even started. No, we started the show. Man, when we show up here, that's when the show starts. You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
When we show up, the party starts.
Everywhere we go is the show.
That's right. The
show follows us.
That's right, right, right.
Yeah.
And so, but we're going to do a little, is this going to be a podcast today? Is this going to be a...
Man, this is going to be a good podcast today. Yeah. Can't be said for all of them.
Yes, it can be said.
Now, today, we're talking about something. So we have a lot of people in here from the Daily Guide Practice Session, from Open Studio Pro. We've got a lot of Open Studio Pro members in here. They know all about what we're talking about today. In fact, we practiced it today on the Daily Guide Practice Session.
Nice.
We're talking about killin comping that anyone can do. So
wait, are we talking about comping or are we talking about practice?
I mean, listen, we're talking about practice. Not a game, not a game.
No, not a game.
Not a game.
Not a game. Certainly
we're
not.
We're talking about practice.
Yeah, we're talking about how to practice Killin Comping.
We're never going back.
For the game.
There was today, and then there was before today.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So should we start the show? I mean, it's almost 3:30. There was today, and there was the day Adam learned what those buttons mean.
Oh, so awesome. That would be something that would interest me.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, would that be something you might be interested in?
That's too much already. That's already three times.
Okay.
Yeah, man. Okay.
It's
so
interesting. Juan says, and I dream of you making a course with Chucho Valdez, the Latin jazz piano master.
Interesting.
Man, so
where have I heard that before?
In our little coffee shop meeting the other day, yeah. We talked about that. But you know what? I just heard.
That was a little awkward. Remember that guy? There was Peter and I met to talk about like possible future artists.
Yeah.
And actually, Juan Chucho was on that list. We're huge Chucho fans. Who wouldn't want to have him on in their orbit? But we were talking about Open Studio and you know all the cool things we've done. And then some guy was like, you know what? Some guy just uninvited.
He had been listening to us.
Yeah, just came up to our table and was like, "Have you guys ever thought about Patreon?" And we were like,
"We're like, thank you, sir."
And we're like, "Yeah, we know about Patreon. Yeah,
yeah."
Yes, they should do this, but on Patreon. That's kind of what his point was.
I'm seeing how quickly I could possibly find. I have such a great picture with Chucho Valdez, and I love it because we had a lot of trouble fitting both of us in the same frame, as you can imagine.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know this, but
two big heads. Big heads.
Chucho, big personalities. Big egos.
Yeah.
No, Chucho is approximately 6'6", maybe 6'7".
So he's a large person.
He's a large person. Now, not by far the tallest gentleman I've ever taken a picture with, but on the taller side. And it's a really just a great picture because it always warms my heart. I'm vamping here to see if I could find this, that would be
Chris,
awesome.
Chris, no, that's the Exxon Valdez. That's a different thing.
Come on. Okay, so what's the address here? Would that be a weird way to find it?
Peter, what is going on today? What? Are we doing a show, or are you ordering
dude,
pizza?
Dude, I'm trying to find his picture, man.
Is this guy ordering Postmates?
Folks, let me know in the comments if you would be interested in seeing this picture. Is that something that would interest you?
Peter, you have like your vegan shake machine right out there. If you're
hungry.
What are
you talking about? What are you talking about?
It looks like you're ordering something on your phone.
I found it. There you go. How do you like that? Okay, what do we do with it now? Oh, you know what?
I'm floored. People, I'm so glad people aren't paying for this.
What are you talking about?
What is happening? What are you doing?
Check this out. Check this out. This is how we roll here.
Okay.
Okay. We're going to look.
They do. Someone says Uber Pete's. I like it.
This is good. Oh, unfortunately, it's a format that I'm not familiar with, so I have to now export it. Should we give a little peek behind the scenes?
No. Nobody wants a peek behind the scenes.
Okay, I'm putting the camera on you, buddy. No,
everybody fill just
him,
wants
fill
to.
Fill them in until I get this done. How about that?
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. So we.
Once you see this picture, you're going to be like, thank you, sir.
Well, yeah, you've built it up now. It better be damn good. I mean, you really better be being crowded out of the frame.
Tell them how about the podcast that's coming up. There you go. I got to give you something to do so you get, you know, get
so
off my
we
head.
Are, so that's a good point. So we are doing, we are doing a podcast in a couple, I hope a couple minutes. God, who knows at this point. I hope we're doing a podcast a couple minutes all about this Killin Comping that anyone can do. And so this is something that I like to teach a lot, especially with our Open Studio Pro folks. We work on this quite a bit. This is like what Red Garland does sort of as his home base for a comping rhythm. It's so interesting, man. And it's something that kind of gets past a lot of people. And then you're like, wait, is that really all that's going on here? And the answer is, yeah, it's simpler than you think. And it's something that anybody can do to sound pretty good, like out of the gate.
Right. Right. Okay. Well, is this something that would interest you, sir?
Oh my God. Yeah. Okay. This was worth it. This was worth it. He is
enormous. I love that guy, man. I love
Chucho
Valdez.
Look at this. What a great smile too. Look, I know. The guy is like so...
And Chucho's smile is nice as well.
That's what he's like on stage too. He just like radiates light. You
yes.
know what I mean?
Then, and when we talk about, you know, being an honest artist, this is what it's about, right? Oh, is that your little, is that a little background Chucho music?
Little noodles for you.
Little noodles. Someone was asking for your noodles. I love Chucho as well. But yeah, you know, yeah, his personality of his playing, and that's just the way he is. But there you go. So, shall we do?
Really hopeful all of a sudden, you know what I mean?
What was that? Just a little noodling.
Just a little noodling on a 251, buddy. Little advanced 251 there.
All right, cool.
Shall we
get cordless headphones. I know, they see me struggling here, you know? Cordless headphones, a little problem called latency.
Yeah, folks, we don't want to add another layer of...
Actually, this works now.
Just got to get it over to the side, bud.
So I'll give you a little foreshadowing.
You just got to put it, just got to adjust it just a little bit over to the left.
Yeah, because you got the whole thing over there.
You
know what I'm saying? That's going to be, we're going to play those voicings, those Red Garland voicings, aren't we? But there's a little dispute.
Well, so that's going to be part of the episode. We're going to have a little dispute. Shall we do it?
Let's do it.
Here we go. Ready?
Yes.
Peter, are you ready for this?
I'm ready. Are you ready?
Here we go.
Yeah.
Hey, Peter.
Oh, it turns out I wasn't ready. Sorry.
Man, this is waste space, Peter. Just waste recording space. You ready?
Maybe
Jeez,
I'm ready. Maybe I'm not.
Such a frustrating partner sometimes. Here we go. You ready?
Yes.
Hey, Peter.
Hey, Adam.
Do you know what we're doing today?
A podcast?
I'll play it and tell you what it is later.
Wow. You like that button, don't you?
We got to do that again. Horrible. We had really bad luck.
We have perfect timing.
You ready?
Yes.
I put this pad in there just for this intro, by the way.
Try okay.
To, ready? Hey, Peter.
Hey, Adam.
Do you have any idea of what we're doing today?
A podcast?
I'll play it and tell you what it is later.
Mmm.
I'm Adam Maness.
And I'm Peter Martin.
And you're listening to the You'll Hear It podcast.
Music advice coming at you.
Coming at you today. Oh, Peter.
What?
Sounds good over there, man. That sounds really good. Don't stop it. Don't
Who
stop
we brought
it.
By? Who we brought here by?
We're brought to you by Open Studio. Of course, go to openstudiojazz.com for all of your jazz lesson needs.
Yeah.
Peter, we got some new sounds here on the keyboards. Give them a little taste. Give them just a little taste. Ooh. I told them just a little taste. We're going to be here all night now.
Yeah, oh. It really, you know.
Modulation. So those are our new Keyscape sounds. Shout out to Keyscape. Can we get a Keyscape sponsorship to the podcast? I mean, come on.
If we do, we'll give you a shout out. Oops, we already gave you one.
Yeah, look at this. We got dual hammer 88s.
And bam, big shout out to
flying
Keyscape.
Dual flying hammer 88s with the Keyscapes.
Big shout out to Keyscape for being able to make such a massive piece of software that works on this. What is this? When did you purchase this? 1984?
Yeah, that's a 1999 MacBook.
That came out the year of the famous
It's pretty
Apple.
Old, man.
Yeah.
It's pretty old. And it sounds really good.
But it does. It sounds good. And we're driving it from two. From two keyboards at the same time, right?
Yeah,
With two different sounds or same sound?
Two different sounds. We got some layers going on here because it sounds so nice. Yeah. So what up, Keyscape? Thank you so much. Today we are talking about killing comping that anyone can do.
Okay, let's be clear here. Okay. We're not talking about killing the comping.
Ooh, yeah. No.
No, some killing comping.
Yeah.
That anyone can do.
Yeah, so when we say comping, just to clarify here, we mean accompanying. We are pianists, and if you're a chordal instrument, like a piano player, a guitarist, even a vibes player, I don't even know why I said even, an accordionist.
You know, I know a gentleman out of the Baltimore area, of our Open Studio artists Now, you're a big guy, but he's bigger.
He's bigger. It sounded disrespectful. I didn't mean any disrespect.
What up, Warren Wolf?
Yeah. No, but if you're any chordal instrument and you have to accompany, we're going to teach you something that if you don't know about, it can really change the game. And it's very, very simple because it's a very repetitive pattern. This is something that we like to teach around here at Open Studio, especially for beginners and intermediate players who are like, my comping rhythm sucks. Like, I'm learning all these great voicings. I can do some cool stuff, some spread voicings or some drop two or some block chords or some magic voicings or whatever. But what do I play rhythmically? And this is what I always teach. And I know you teach similar things about the principles behind this.
Yep.
This is the red garland sound, the red rhythm.
That's red. Why did you go down to this voice?
Because reds, I think, you know, we talk about melody being beautiful and we talk about harmony being beautiful. No one talks about beautiful rhythm. Red had beautiful rhythm.
He did.
Beautiful
he did.
Rhythm.
Yeah. And precise, but human. Inventive, but you know, systematic, as we're going to see at times.
Yeah,
when it needs to be. So super excited and stoked for the episode. And I was just thinking of another usage of the term comping.
Yeah.
So we talked about comping, accompanying.
Yeah.
There's the comping. You know, oh, you've got a gig. Can you get me comped? We're not talking about that kind. Can you comp me at the door?
Oh, we do a lot of that kind of comping too, but we're not talking about that. And don't ask for it.
Don't ask for it, right.
Yeah. So we are talking about accompanying. We're talking about playing some chords. More specifically, what this is going to be about, we have some voicings. We can get into that towards the end of the episode because there's some controversy around the voicings
we
have. But we're really talking about the rhythm of the comping. That's the most important thing.
So we're talking about the rhythm of the comping. Are we talking about practicing or perhaps...
What?
Are we talking about practice?
I mean, listen, we're talking about practice. Not a game.
Set me up.
We're talking about practice.
You set me up for that.
Okay, sorry.
But I'm more than happy to oblige. I am more than happy
so
to oblige.
So what you're saying is that is something that would interest
Peter,
you.
Peter, don't do it. Peter, don't do it. Say that again. What?
Is that something that might interest you?
Now, would that be something you might be interested in?
Yes, it would be. So let's get to it. Let's listen to what we're going to listen to today. So we had resident Open Studio transcriber Just huge ears, Max. We should call him Big Ears Max because he can hear everything. So this is Max's transcription that he did. I literally texted Max at like 6 a.m.
Yeah.
When I woke up, when I had this idea, and I was like, Max, can you do me a solid?
You
and
just ruined his whole day.
I might have ruined his whole day. But Max is the best, man. Thank you, Max, for this transcription. So this is some chords from the first chorus of Miles Davis's solo on If I Were a Bell from Relaxin'. It's one of those prestige records. Peter, can you bring me up here? Can you hit us up?
Yeah.
For our YouTube folks, maybe lower that a hair so that we can see it.
Yeah. I gotcha.
Maybe go full screen.
Tell them about which record this is from, though.
Go full screen on there for me, buddy, that I can get in there. No, not on the chart, on the send. You know what I mean? Over here on the monitor. Thanks, buddy.
Okay, there. No.
We almost got it. We're getting it together here, folks. So this is from Relax, and this is one of those records that they were just made in a couple days, right? They made those four records in a day. And let's start it from the beginning. We'll hear it all the way from the top. How's that?
Good.
Cool.
I'll play it and tell you what it is later.
That wasn't my button. That's the track. With the Miles Davis Quintet. Does anybody knows what's going on already?
Welcome in, fam.
Check it out. Peter, are you hearing this? You hearing what's going on?
Yes.
So we're gonna stop it here. That's the transcription we have. So we will have a transcription here linked in the show notes for you by Thursday, and we'll have this uploaded here and linked in the video once we're done here with the live. And the reason is because there's still some work to do on this transcription. So let's just ignore the voicings for now because there's something that we can talk about there.
Yeah.
Because it's interesting what Max wrote and what I think is going on. There's a little discrepancy that we can talk about.
Battle Royale.
A little controversy there.
Battle in the transcription studio.
Hey, listen, this is not easy to hear.
I know.
Just from the sound recording here.
Yeah.
So it's kind of there's some guesswork to be done. But let's just talk about the main point of this episode.
Yeah.
And that is that rhythm of the and of four and the end of two.
Yeah.
So that's not the end. That's not all he didn't just go into that as a automatic, but it is like 75-80% of what he's playing here.
Yes.
And a four and a two. And one note on this too is he is not playing, if it's a G7 chord, and it's like a bar of G7, he's not playing G7 on the and of four of that bar.
No.
He's playing G7 on the and of four of the bar just before it. So he's anticipating the next bar with the chord that's going to be there a half a beat early.
Yep.
So if it's one, two, three,
ahead.
Four. Right. Anticipating that beat. So
it's an anticipatory.
It's an anticipatory.
Yet participatory.
Chord. So I promise you, if you haven't ever sort of gotten this in your playing, if you use this for a while as your home base, I want you to try this on your next gig with a drummer. And then I want you to look at your drummer's face when you start doing this. And I want you to watch the joy come over their face as things just lean forward a little bit. Everything feels nice and grooving. They've got some space to do some stuff. The pocket is wide but deep. Yeah. It all feels really, really good. So you're doing a couple of things. I'm going to go on a rant here for a second because I love it so much. Just listening to Red do it, who is the master, sounds so good. So a couple of things happen here. So first of all, the rhythm, when you get into that sort of clip of and a four and a two. 1, 2, 3, 4. Ga, 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 ga. And again, you're anticipating the beat. 1, 2, 3, 4. When you start doing that, you're propelling that beat forward, right? You're making the entire thing sort of lean forward. Now, when Red also anticipates the harmony with that, yes, right, leading into the bar, you are setting up everybody in the band. You're setting up your listener for
your dear listeners.
The dear listener, you're setting up for what is about to happen harmonically. Like, yeah, you're just projecting just a slight bit into the future, not too much, just a little bit in the future. You're setting it up. So there's a difference here. We actually did this earlier today in a practice session. So Peter, let's just play just the 1A here of If I Were a Bell in F.
Okay.
You know the changes?
Yep.
Sure you do. So I'm going to play here, not on the end of 4 and the end of 2. I'm going to let the change happen, then okay, I'm going to react. And this is what you hear a lot of beginner and a lot of intermediate compers do. Like, the change goes by, yeah, and then they play the chord, and then the next change goes by.
Right. They're a step behind.
They're a little step behind. So let's hear that, just 4 8 bars of that.
So I'll walk you a little bit.
Well, give me a little walking bass. Okay. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so that's that. Now let's do Red's thing.
That sounded like poop.
It sounds terrible, but you hear a lot of people do that because it's understandable,
yeah,
right? You're thinking about the changes and whatever. But if you're a little proactive,
yeah,
if you gently guide everybody and you say, hey, everybody, this way.
Let's get on the Red Garland train.
Follow Red. Let's try that. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, and... Anticipating, how's that feel?
Yeah.
It feels a lot better, right?
Yeah.
It feels just everything happens a lot more naturally. You know where we're going. And all the while, everything is leaning forward.
Yes. And I think the leaning forward, that's what really typifies this kind of, you know, the interaction between the comping, the possible interaction that you're able to capitalize on with the actual groove. So it's not just about, you know, there's a whole nother angle to it of just great comping behind what the soloist is playing, which is always our main job. So it's almost like accomplishing a couple things at the same time. Like, we could analyze it from the standpoint of, like, how is that reaction and stuff. And at first glance, it seems like, oh, he's just doing the same thing over and over again.
Yeah.
But he gets that feel. And I want to talk a little bit, if we can,
yeah,
just
absolutely,
about when, like you said, 70, 80% or whatever it was that he's doing that. It seems like it's random when he's not, but it's far from
it. Well, here's the thing. So I think our first reaction is like, well, how does he communicate with what's going on?
Yeah.
If he's laying in the band, well, how does a drummer communicate if they're like, if they're doing the spang-a-lang, right? Yeah. If they're doing the walk the dog, they still communicate. And it's the same thing here. You can lay in a groove. You can hang in a pocket and still pick your spots to get in there.
That's right.
I think Red proves this perfectly. Now, you know,
and the phrasing, like his touch and his phrasing, we can't decouple these rhythms and the harmonies and the you know, the beat placements
for
from
sure.
that as
no,
well.
No, no. It all
because that gives
in real time,
it like,
yeah,
you know, that gives it that lilt as well. They're all connected. There's an organic flow to the comping that actually makes it easier for you to be a little bit more aggressive and busy even. I mean, like, just look at this visually. I mean, it's a pretty busy situation, especially like the way, like, and this is one of those great Miles Davis. Can we just hear his solo break? Just because I hate talking about it when, you know what I'm saying? Like, that, what he plays going into this chorus.
Let's see if I can back it up.
Okay. Yeah. Check it out. Ah, is that on the and though?
Well, I would say
the first one. The second one's definitely on the beat. Because that's big. Like, it's not a right or a wrong thing, but because.
Oh, is Red on the end?
Yeah.
Let's hear that again.
One of the greatest little melodic interludes.
Yeah.
check out Miles. Oh no, it's on the beat.
It's on the beat.
Okay, good. So that, because I was gonna have to change my commentary on this. So the fact that he plays on the beat and the whole rhythm section does really, they didn't always do that, but it's so right and not correct. It's right, or is it the other way around? I can't remember. It's the dope thing to do in this situation because it's of good. How Miles it's such a laid back but precision right in the cut eighth note situation that Miles playing with that.
There's really
the intonation.
There's not many situations where it's just like I'm on the one.
Right.
That's going to be wrong. But that's especially at the top of a form.
I know, but for this kind of thing, that's a real confident thing to do.
It
because
is a confident
normally
thing.
It's like,
yeah.
Shaking the deck and bang, bang. Yeah. And then, of course, he gets to that, but in a very light way, very much after this. But I would say that because he starts out, you know, like, and then goes in there. Man, it's just such a cool thing in terms of like the architecture of it sets it off, because if you just heard this you'd be like, oh, he's just comping, you know, and a lot of people like start comping like that. Oh, I'm Red Garland. But it's like you got to know those places where you do that one thing that's on the downbeat, and also the stuff later on when he omits and goes radio silence for a few beats.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's like anything. He set up a rhythmic pattern, hip one.
That's
so when perfect. You're going to pull the rug out for a minute and then place it back under the soloist can be the most exciting part of it.
So now let's pay attention. Notice when Red is on the end of four and the end of two. And then notice when Red decides to go off of that and how powerful that now is. Let's try it.
Right there.
So that's a great moment. That dunk, dunk,
Yeah.
And then check out what happens after it. One more of those.
Oh, and that accent and that boom on that.
Turns it around there.
Exactly. Yeah.
So there are definitely, he's on the beat a couple of times, you know, but he's setting up that and of four, and of two. Again, you can try to practice this really easily and then try to play off of it.
Right here. Yeah. Sorry, go ahead. I just saw there's another screen here. I can look at it. That's so exciting. Oh, and you have another one too. What? Yeah, I
did. Did you get distracted?
No, I'm just excited that I got another copy of it over here.
Did someone throw a shiny ball that way? Peter just turned around in the middle of the show.
Hey, who'd you call a shiny ball guy?
Buddy, we have a bunch of listeners live.
Hey,
people have invested their time up to this point.
Well, shame on them.
17 minutes and 58 seconds in,
no
and
one
you get
noticed.
Distracted
no.
and turn around in your seat.
Nobody would have cared. Now you brought attention to it, big guy.
Oh, my God.
No, but the thing is, you're absolutely right about that. But before we even get there, we've got to highlight. I don't want it to miss. What Mozart said, what you don't write is just as important what you do write. Wolfgang Amadeus, by the way, in case you're wondering. Not the guy we just saw down at the diner, Johnny Mozart.
Nobody's
named
Mozart. Nobody's named Mozart.
Bar 13 right here.
Yeah.
Nothing. Radio silence until that last one. That's big. Can we listen to that again?
Sure.
This sounds great. Of course we can listen to it. But let's just talk about it. So now we're in the constant... and a two and a four. The more you do it, the more it becomes boom, like a pattern.
Yep. And now he's gonna
you get a bar break there. And that's such a subtle thing, but it's so important. Bing, bing,
bah. And that's a great fill there.
Bang, yeah,
totally.
And then it's almost like he gives it that whole bar again of that. We're at the second half of the tune. It's a double form. So in that, whatever it is, bar 20, 19, 18, 17. Yeah, 17, because it's 16 bars and 16 bars. Bar 17, he plays nothing. That's the first bar where there's nothing at all. He's totally, like, absent. And then setting up that great bonk, bing, gong in the 18th bar.
It's great stuff. It's really something to study. You can listen to Red on any of these records, any of those Miles Davis records, and hear just this distinct style and something that you can do like tomorrow, that anyone can do. Practice this and a four and a two. Practice anticipating the harmony right before it comes and you won't be sorry. So let's talk a little bit, Peter, about the voicings here, because Max came back at me this afternoon with some of these voicings, and it is hard to hear.
Should we go?
But I'm a little bit, that's pretty good. So I have a little experience transcribing some Red Garland, so I think I know what's going on. So I've actually, these, the first two bars are me, and everything else is Max, but Max was going with a lot of rootless voicings, a lot of three-note voicings, and I don't, I disagree with him, but I don't, I know exactly why he, what he's hearing. He's hearing what the only thing you can really hear. Like he's hearing the only pitches that are actually audible.
Yeah.
But there is a weight that's underneath these chords that I think these are rooted voicings when you actually listen to them. I think you, it's like dark matter. Like you can't, you can only know it by its like impression against actual matter.
Yeah.
So there just is, if he wasn't playing the roots, to me, this would sound different. But let's see if you can, if you agree with me or if you agree with your
so binary
professional transcriber.
Yeah.
So hard to hear. So that's the thing. It's like, so here, and this is just for our YouTube audience here to see what we have now, because we're going to hopefully have this pretty fleshed out by the time we...
Well, we may or may not. I mean, you know, the thing about this is like, I always think in, with transcription, you shouldn't go beyond what you know you can hear. I appreciate what you're saying in terms of like, the kind of ghost notes, the antimatter or whatever, like that you figure are there.
Well, it's yeah,
and probably at that part, but it gets to the point like if you can't hear it, and we look, we even broke this down and isolated with any tune to try to
we
see
did.
If
we
did.
We used
some
any tune, yeah.
But the thing is, I think less is more. A transcription. If you're not sure it's there, leave it out. You know that I don't know.
So I'm just hearing. So like, for
I do
instance,
have a dispute like with the very first bar.
Okay, what do you got?
Right.
Yeah, that's what I had.
No, you have.
Oh, sorry. Yep, sorry. That's just some bad copy and paste there. Yeah, that should be a B natural. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay.
No, that's true.
This is a real-time show.
So, but
self-edited.
But here's the difference. So for me, so
you
Matt,
also have a little piece of lint on your shoulder. No, I'm just kidding. That was a joke.
Oh, is that true?
Yeah, yeah.
So, but no, it's just something to think about. So yeah. Max had this, which is what you can hear. But I hear a punchier, weightier voicing, and because they're short too, right? Because he's just playing like. I think he's got the root down there. And also, I've transcribed Red before. And if you listen to the melody where you can hear him playing a little clearer, you can hear even like...
He's using some of the same voices. Yeah, yeah.
He's like leading in with them. So, and you know Red, like
yeah.
if he starts one way, as you said when we were kind of talking about this earlier, he starts like a pattern, like a structure.
Yeah.
He usually sticks with
that's
it.
Right.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I think that's a valid, for sure, a valid way of transcribing. Even taking things that you know that you've... where you can clearly hear a certain player play even on another tune, another album or whatever, but you know that they like to go to in that situation. I think that's valid then if you're not sure to go ahead and put that in, because we all have our kind of go-to things for similar types of situations, as it were.
So let's listen again and see if you can hear
if we have to.
I mean, so let us know what you think the voicing structure is. Do you think it's rooted, or do you think that it's this sort of rootless voicing that Max has? I think either is kind of a valid listen of this, because it's really hard to hear the low end of the piano. But let us know your thoughts in the comments. Yeah. Yeah, it's just,
me likey. That's something
so
I would
good.
Like.
It's so good. Is that something you'd be interested
yes.
in?
Now, would that be something you might be interested in?
You know what? We haven't totally got together.
What?
We're next level with this is going to be like we're both saying them things and then you play them. Like we have to figure out a way to actually just, you know, when you're thinking it, then you trigger.
Yeah. I'll play it and tell you what it is later.
Like that.
Exactly.
Thanks, everybody, for listening today. We're sponsored by Open Studio. Go to openstudiojazz.com to go on a deeper dive on all this. Peter, you going to take us out, or should I take us out here?
Let's do both. How about? Can it be both?
It can.
Okay.
Till next time.
You'll hear it.
Thank you, everybody. Oh, Anthony Wiggins is on here. Is there? What's up, Tony Wiggins? He says, "Is there comping going on?" Oh, I was listening to Miles. It is distracting to try to hear the piano when Miles.
It's such a great solo. Yeah. Such a great solo.
Let's see. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in today. Isn't that fun? So you know what, man?
You know what this sounds like? Remember that solo we analyzed a couple years ago in there?
Oh, that's Lingus. Lingus. Yeah, we went on a deep analyzation of that. We really took it to it. Got deep in there.
Literally the second time we were listening to it in real time.
Oh, wait. Max updated the transcription.
What? Oh, we get a little bonus for the YouTube.
A little bonus. Okay, we're going to put this in here. Hold on.
See, we just had a huge drop off of listener at the end of the podcast.
They're missing it. They're missing it.
Always stay till the end. Always stay till the end. What? Always stay till the end.
Jeez.
Always stay till the end. Wow. Oh, they're back. They're back.
They came back. They heard you. All right. I got to sign into. Do you have Basecamp? Jeez.
Yeah, I got it.
Oh, wait, I got it. Thank you, Max, if you're watching.
It's probably on the sound slides. Eh?
Not yet. I'm going to put the, actually, let me give the PDF here. All right, y'all, because you waited so patiently, I think we're going to kill these live comments after the fact. See if we can't.
Noodles
McKee. How's everybody doing? That was a pretty good episode.
That was a very good episode. Did you press record? That's always the question.
I did press record.
If we have any faults, it's that occasionally we don't press record. I do love these keyboard sounds. Give us a shout in the comments if you're enjoying the Keyscape.
He already has it.
Is it on the
It's on SoundSlice. I'm about to share the SoundSlice link in here, folks. Thank you so much for sticking
with us. Can we
look
at it on here?
Yeah. Give me a second here.
It's okay. It's all good.
Here's the SoundSlice link for your viewing pleasure. Okay, let's see.
Oh, you want it like that?
Yeah, there we go.
Oh, look at that. It's got the new.
No, not yet.
Okay. No, it doesn't.
Hold on. I gotta get to it here, Peter.
There. That's something that would interest you.
That is.
Oh, we can't let them see that. We can't let them see behind the iron. Oh, we need to let them.
We gotta see something. Oh. All right, I'm gonna bring it over here. All right, go back. Thanks, everybody, for sticking around. So there's the SoundSlice link, and then we can actually bring it up here in just a second. Thank you to Max Gamiz for everything, really. For being hip. So Max and I, before we went on the air, we talked about it. And man, SoundSlice is looking good. You know, they changed this from editing. It was like editing and viewing, and now it's editing and practicing.
And look, y'all, go get your SoundSlice account. It's free.
Yeah.
I mean, our account isn't free, but the basic is not that basic either. It's really nice. Become a part of the community over there. Join us at soundslice.com/openstudio. Oh, you need to see something.
Just give it a little bigger, just for a second. Just for a second.
Okay.
Give me camera four, just for a second.
This is camera four. Boom.
Thank you. There we go. Okay. All right. You ready? There it is. He just added some roots.
I'll blend.
Oh.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. You can, when you play this on a real piano, you can hear that.
Yeah.
I don't know anybody else that you could text in the morning and they have like a chord transcription from a 50s recording by the afternoon. It's pretty incredible.
Yeah.
Thank you, Max.
Yeah, great stuff. Thank you guys, everybody, for being here. Thank you, Adam, man. Thanks for the idea.
Yeah, it's great stuff.
And thanks for the Keyscape.
Keyscape sounds so good.
We want to wish everybody, our dear listeners, a happy week. Stay lifted. What do we got happening around Open Studio? Oh!
We got some exciting stuff happening this week.
We do. We always do. We do.
A couple of really exciting front of the house things that we're recording this week.
Yeah. Should we drop a hint about... We're going to...
I'm recording.
I don't want to jinx it.
I'm finishing a course this week. Yeah, of course. We called the Scales and Chords course. Ever heard of it?
Yeah.
Now, would that be something you might be interested in?
Scales and Chords course.
See, now you're using it correctly.
I know. So it's really all about... It's going to be a very basic course, but...
Basic bop.
It's all about how to practice scales. Kind of what we were talking about earlier at the beginning of the show, Peter. So not just practicing scales, but practicing them in thirds. Like we practice together in thirds.
Yeah.
In triads.
Yep.
In broken seventh chords.
Yep.
Practicing all these ways that really help us lock it in. And then we do get a little geeky with what, like I talk about in the course, what dominant scale to use over what dominant chord.
Yeah.
He's falling asleep.
No. I'll see if you're paying attention.
No, just like the question is about what notes to play, really. Yeah. I mean, besides the language part of it, which is what we're all shooting for, but where are you going? How are you going to know where you're going?
Wait. If you don't know where you've been.
How do you know? There's some very profound statement in there somewhere.
If you don't know where you've been, how do you know where you're going?
We're recording some
Stevie Wonder,
later this week.
That might make it into the video.
Yeah.
Should we tell them the title? No, because it's not decided yet.
Well, that's decided, but we don't want to tease it too much. Man, that sounds so good.
Someone's asking about T-shirt merch. Go to Open Studio Jazz.
You know what? This.
Go to store.
I don't know. Dan, is this available? Someone was mentioning this
Dan Martin,
color.
Is it available?
This is a great color. It's a great color.
Should we take this out?
See you next week.